What would you do if someone you loved vanished from the face of the earth? Not dying at the conclusion of a lingering illness or perishing in an automobile accident. No. What if you woke up one morning and your son, your daughter, your sister, or your brother simply wasn't there? Gone. Missing. Reading the newspaper on the morning of October 16th, 2002, I came upon a story whose headline read, "Tears and Hugs as Five Abducted Japanese Go Home to Visit." A quick internet search turned up a photograph of five middle-aged Japanese, two couples and a single woman, wearing boxy 1950s-era suits, thin ties, and prim skirts, descending the steps of a Japan Airlines 727 at Tokyo's Haneda Airport. The story was almost too bizarre to believe. Evil frogmen emerging from the inky sea, snatching young couples from beaches, and transporting them by boat to Pyongyang, where they were held prisoner for decades. But here it is, from one of the many made-for-TV Japanese dramas inspired by the abduction. People began disappearing from Japan's coastal towns and cities in the fall of 1977. A security guard vacationing at a seaside resort 200 miles northwest of Tokyo vanished in September. In November, a 13-year-old girl walking home from badminton practice in the port city of Niigata was last seen 800 feet from her front door. The next July, two young couples disappeared. One left behind the car they drove to a local makeout spot. The other couple abandoned the bicycles they rode to the beach. What few knew at the time was that they had been abducted by an elite crew of North Korean commandos. And Japanese were not the only victims. Some were abducted from the Middle East, Asia, and Eastern Europe during the same time period. Their families spent years searching for the missing, checking mortuaries, hiring private detectives, and even consulting soothsayers. Only five Japanese were ever seen again. For the next quarter century, the abductees lived in a series of guarded communities on the outskirts of Pyongyang. Known as invitation-only zones, the fiction was that these were not prisons, but merely exclusive areas for which one required an invitation. The zones were essentially terrariums where, in addition to learning Japanese from the abductees, North Korean spies observed them on a daily basis. Resigned to their fate, the abductees learned Korean, got married, had children, and tried to live as normally as is possible in the totalitarian nation. Hitomi Soga, who was kidnapped while walking home from the local grocery store, married Charles Jenkins, an American sergeant who had defected to North Korea. In the background of Jenkins's vacation photo, you can see Anoka Panjoy, a Thai abductee who married another of the American deserters. And here is Megumi Yokota, the 13-year-old girl who married an abductee from South Korea. They, like the others, attempted to pass as North Korean, hiding their identities even from their children, who grew up worshiping Kim Il-sung, and performed in the Mass Games, an annual celebration of the North Korean state. Why had these unlucky souls been abducted in the first place? It seems the plan was to brainwash the abductees into believing the regime's ideology, a peculiar blend of Stalinism and Korean nationalism. and trained them to spy on the state's behalf. When that project faltered, they were made to teach North Korean spies how to pass as Japanese in order to infiltrate South Korea and other countries. Because the locations they were taken from were dispersed and their numbers relatively small, few drew a connection between the incidents in the late 1970s. When rumors about the abductions appeared in Japanese newspapers, they were treated like urban myths, akin to alien abductions. The police told the families of the missing that with no bodies or evidence of foul play, there was nothing for them to investigate. After all, thousands of people disappear every day, every year, dying lonely deaths or fleeing drugs, debts, or unhappy relationships. It later turned out that some Japanese officials knew about the abductions at the time. They avoided acknowledging them officially, likely out of fear that doing so might get the abductees killed. And what, after all, could be done? Japan has neither diplomatic relations with North Korea nor a military that is allowed to take unilateral action. Shigata Gannai, it can't be helped, is the phrase Japanese often use to rationalize their inaction. So they languished in the invitation-only zones until 2002, when Kim Jong-il allowed five of them to visit Japan. Why free them now? Between the death of its founder, Kim Il-sung, in 1994, and the famine that killed nearly 1 million people in the late 1990s, North Korea was on the brink of collapse. In January 2002, George W. Bush banished North Korea to the Axis of Evil. Desperate, Kim Jong-il asked to meet Japanese Prime Minister Koizumi, hoping to cultivate a wealthy ally who had good relations with the United States. Of the 13 Japanese that North Korea admitted taking, Kim claimed that 8 were dead. The circumstances of their deaths, however, were suspicious. One had succumbed to heart disease at the age of 27. Another had committed suicide, and two others died in automobile accidents in a country with few cars. Also suspicious was the fact that all the death certificates were issued by the same hospital. 1 month after the summit, the abductees arrived in Tokyo for a temporary visit. As I watched them disembark from the airplane, I wondered to myself, who were these people who had spent half their lives in the least accessible nation on Earth? What might they tell us about the secretive country? Having split their lives between North Korea and Japan, with which did they identify? Had they been brainwashed? How many others might have been abducted? Were any of them still alive? Japanese television ran nonstop live coverage all day, and the abductions became a national obsession, dominating the media for years. A public once relatively indifferent to North Korea now couldn't get enough news about the strange country. A government poll found that 80% of Japanese believed that the two countries were on the brink of war. The look on the five abductees' faces alternated between joy and terror. Joy at seeing their loved ones after so much time, and terror that the army of reporters would ask questions which, if answered truthfully, might imperil the sons and daughters left behind in North Korea as hostages. Their predicament was summed up by the two pins they wore on their lapels that October day. One was a blue flag, the symbol of the abductee rescue movement. The other was an image of Kim Il-sung, a pin that every North Korean is required to wear close to his heart. The two symbols, only inches from one another, represent irreconcilable narratives. One told the story of Japanese abductees escaping from the North Korean jailers. The other was the story of loyal North Korean citizens visiting their families in Japan and then returning home to their children. 1 year before, the events of September 11th had shaken me. Standing on the roof of a Brooklyn brownstone, I saw the Twin Towers fall. I recoiled at the nationalism that swept through the country and was depressed as I watched the terrorists trick us into curtailing the very freedoms that had made us a great nation. In an odd way, I threw myself into the story of the abductions to avoid America's nervous breakdown. In 2002, Japan was also struggling to define its national character. Its economy in decline and its birth rate in freefall, its crisis of faith brought it to a crossroads. Was it the militarist aggressor that had colonized Asia and attacked the United States? Or the pacifist nation, victimized by the atomic bomb and now the abduction of its citizens? My Japanese friends told me that the abductions were Japan's 9/11. This puzzled me at first, but as I witnessed the country redoubling its counterterrorism strategy and tightening its immigration controls, I began to understand that Japan's 9/11 was less an event than a state of mind. Like the United States, Japan was traumatized by the sudden realization that the world was more dangerous than it had thought. A place where even the most prosperous and powerful nations are incapable of protecting themselves, whether from Al-Qaeda or North Korea. The Japanese people have been living in a greenhouse since the American occupation ended in 1952, the journal's Tsutomu Watanabe tells me. In 2002, we realized that the outside world was actually cold and hostile. And with trauma came the seduction of victimhood, a status that neither Japan nor the United States had had much claim to. When I arrived at Narita Airport on a chilly March morning in 2008, I discovered that the story was stranger and more complex than I had imagined. The abductions had become a proxy for some of Asia's most vexed historical disputes, which continue to be fought over to this day. Whenever I'm in Tokyo, I stop in at the offices of Radio Shiokaze, a shortwave broadcast that has been beamed into North Korea twice a day since 2006. The intended audience is abductees who many believe are still being held captive. The programs are in Japanese, English, Chinese, and Korean, and each episode is a mix of international news and messages for individual abductees, often read by friends or relatives. The project is a pure act of faith, a broadcast whose signal is jammed, directed at a country where radios receive only official stations and where electricity is scarce, to be heard by abductees who may not exist. For its part, North Korea has promised to reinvestigate the abductions. Their report is due in early 2016.